Hi everybody and welcome to our masterclass. My name is Merette Khahil and I'm here representing Your Egyptian Doula and White Ribbon Alliance. And I'm joined by my lovely colleague Joy. Over to you.
Thank you, Merette. And adding my welcome, I'm Professor Joy Lawn from the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine and also the Nest 360 Alliance. And it's really a privilege to be here to talk on behalf of 140 authors from 80 organisations about the Born Too Soon report. So 10 years ago, the first Born Too Soon report brought new data, the first ever data on preterm birth around the world, to shine a light on what this means for newborns and also, very importantly, for their families. So things that were different about that report was the power of new data mixed with human stories, especially women's voices of what that meant to them, and then a huge partnership. And that ignited a movement. And without that movement, we would never have got a sustainable development goal for newborn survival. It really helped us to bring stillbirths to the fore in a new way, even though we didn't get a goal that should be there for those very important 2 million deaths a year. And also put at the centre women and families and their rights. So this report is saying 10 years of a movement, what has changed and what hasn't and what needs to happen more. Similar themes that we're seeing here with progress stalling for maternal mortality, for stillbirths and for neonatal deaths with 7 years to go to the SDGs. And so what do we see in this report? Our top finding really comes out of the numbers. Small babies, but very big numbers. There are still 13.4 million newborns who are born too soon every year. That's one every 2 seconds. And every 40 seconds, one of those vulnerable newborns will die. And one of the most horrifying things is that that rate of preterm birth is utterly a flat line over the last decade. So really, we weren't expecting it to be like that. And this is not just a low-income country problem. In high-income countries, the rate is also a flat line. There are only about 5 countries that have gone more than a 5% reduction in 10 years, 0.5% per year, which is pretty much a flat line. So an urgent message out of this report is we need to do better for preterm prevention. And this is around women's rights, sexual and reproductive health, better quality antenatal care, improved care at birth, but also need to go beyond the health sector, which we will come to importantly. So small babies, very big numbers, preterm rates are flatlining. And what we underline there is this is really about inequalities and vulnerabilities. So even within high-income countries, for example, the US has double the preterm rates of Northern Europe, and within the US, African Americans have a higher risk again. So this is a reflection, whether you're in a rich country or a low-income country, of inequalities. Our health system should be judged on how it delivers for the most vulnerable. And there is no more vulnerable user of your health system than a small preterm baby. They can die literally in seconds. So this is something that we can take as an indicator of whether our health systems are delivering. And there has been change in the last 10 years that enables us to go faster. We have new interventions, we have innovations, we have better measurement. So we are calling for action on 2 tracks. First of all, better prevention of preterm birth, and then secondly, to close the survival gaps for those babies who are born too soon and too vulnerable. And in looking at the prevention side, there are many things that we can and we must take forward. But even if we do all of these, we will still have a gap. So we need very intentional investment in research that will actually close that gap. For those preterm babies that are born now around the world, there is much that we can do that we couldn't do a decade ago. And we have a real focus on providing a systems approach. Because for a preterm baby, I was a neonatologist once in the UK. The average baby has more than one device. They often have 10 or 15 or 20 devices, but they also need more nurses. We need neonatal nurses, we need midwives, and we do need doctors as well. But it's actually the numbers of neonatal nurses and the systems approach with space so that women can have respectful care and be able to be with their preterm babies for care. So there are lots of exciting opportunities. We encourage you to use the report. So I'd like to then recognise that one of the really new things in this report is that wider focus on intersectoral action. I'm going to pass you to the wonderful Merette to talk us through what do we need to do in the next few years to change this.
Thank you, Joy. I'm really struck by what you said around health systems needing to serve the most vulnerable. Mm-hmm. And I think that reminds us that we need accountability. Mm-hmm. We can't be having small and sick vulnerable babies dying or being born too soon. And like you very rightly said, the solution has to be intersectoral. The health system alone will not be able to fix the problem of preterm birth. We've seen this plateauing over the last 10 years, and we can't afford to do that for another 10. So today I want to share with you what we found as the proposed five areas for intersectoral action. These are summarized as the five E's. So starting with E number one, equity. We need gender transformative approaches. And like you very correctly said, Joy, this needs to be intersectional. One of the very exciting things about the report this time around is for the first time we're talking about the rights of women mm-hmm. to respectful care, but also we're talking about rights and respect for the newborn as well as the healthcare providers providing the care. Mm-hmm. We need this both supply and demand side when we're talking about the health system. And we need to also recognize this issue of equity and rights for everyone involved. Brings us to E number two, education. Who are some of the most vulnerable women who are having preterm births? Most of the time it's younger women. And here we need to also remember the issue of bringing age, gender, class, socioeconomic status, all of these different identities that increase the risk and increase the vulnerability for preterm birth. Here, we need to make sure that we're keeping girls in school. We're reducing teen pregnancies, early child marriage. We need to make sure that we're reducing these vulnerabilities at the system level. This brings us to E number three, economic investments. We need to finance and make sure that actually there is financial protection also for newborns and for families. Brings us to E number four, the environment. We need environmentally adaptive systems. We need to make sure that we are delivering on wash, we're delivering on sanitation, we're ensuring that women who are seeking care in health facilities are not getting infected there. Last but not least, we're just coming out of the pandemic. The fifth E is emergencies. We need to make sure that women, newborns, are at the heart of our emergency preparedness plans, emergency adaptation plans, especially when we're talking about climate action. We know that, unfortunately, women, small, tiny babies, are often the most vulnerable. And we need to make sure that their voices and their health is also considered in our adaptation and preparedness plans. So with that, let me give it back to you, Joy, to tell us where do we go from here?
Oh, thank you, Merette. So this report is a decade action, but we're looking for change next week, next month. And within that, we want to call out on these two tracks. What are we doing for prevention? What does that mean for women? What are we doing for better care for newborns? What are we doing to recognise that now three quarters of stillbirths may be preterm? So for all of these critical outcomes, we call together that we act, that we don't compete with each other, but what we need to do is to stand beside governments, especially those with the highest numbers of women and babies dying, and to ensure that we actually implement. Policy is cheap. Actually doing things to reach women, and particularly the most vulnerable, will take money and energy of the levels that we saw for HIV. HIV activists changed what governments did, what societies did, and what business did. Today, we need to do that together for women and for babies, and we can and we must do it now.